you very much. So whereas Dr. Paul did draw a distinction between the science and art, Professor Sudarshan is of the view that that distinction may not always be drawable. Now, my job here is to just bring out what the panelists are saying, so we can have discussions on this later, right? So if you hold an opposing view or you want to support either one of them, that's fine, but we'll wait for that. Dr. Paul did also mention something which is very interesting and which I would like your position on that. He mentioned institutions. Now, and by the way, I'm an economist. So as economists, we ask the question that do we need the institutions first and then design the policy? Or since institutions have a legacy in most societies, so we take the institutions that we have and then design a policy that suits the institutions that we have. And hence, we may end up with not an ideal situation, but which will certainly be incrementally better than what we have now. Your thoughts on that, Dr. Sharma?
Thank you so much. In this, I prefer to call myself as a practitioner development economist. So my view will be absolutely that of a practitioner and not so much of a theory part of it.
By the way, I said economist just to confess.
Yes.
You don't have to, others don't have to confess.
True. So now here, what you are saying of the science and art part of it and the institution building in it, my understanding of science, and when I went through the book and the public policy making throughout the life in career, it is more that when we are talking of science part of it, it is, my understanding is, a paradigm shift for holistic approach. Our public policies are becoming patchworks or knee-jerk reactions. And art of it is that how that holistic approach, we, by public participation, we are able to develop system-based, not personality-based. What survives is system-based. And the moment we approach to it in a system-based, then comes the institution, which will sort of make it sustainable, and it has to be dynamic. It cannot be sort of etched on rock. It has to change as we move ahead. I'd just like to give you a small illustration, two small illustrations. Like if you're talking of social protection systems, we have so much of databases digitized. The time has come where many state governments, and we did it in Samagra, where we have a common household database. And everybody works on the same database. So you have a horizontal line as to what all social protection has gone to that particular family, what economic status is there. Now it's a wonderful database spread over 8 states and 3 countries. So that's one example. Another example, if we don't have a holistic approach, I'll take Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, such laudable step taken ahead. But if it is not supplemented with the sanitation part of it, we have a problem. Another example, like Daring, when RCEP came, they were talking about allowing import of milk powder. Now you have a whole cycle, a holistic approach for Daring. The moment I touch one part of public policy and allow that, I finish the whole cycle. Now, this is what where the institution has to have a hawk's eye that we are having a holistic approach into the any of the sector we are touching, no knee-jerk reaction, and the art of it is how we make it system-based.
But you still did not answer my question.
Right.
To reiterate. Which is, are institutions given to us and we work with whatever institutions we have, or do we first build the right institutions?
See, actually, we should not waste time in rebuilding. We can transform the existing institutions. Because institution building is a time-consuming job. You start today on a scratch, you will end up 10 years down the line. We do have excellent work being done, but again, I'll say it's done here, there, everywhere. There is no consolidated way we can do. So best is the existing appropriate institution should be made to go ahead with it and go ahead and deliver the results. Because ultimately public policy has to be result oriented and sustainable result oriented.